Italian Front is a two-player operational level game about World War II in Italy, beginning with the invasion of Sicily in 1943 and ending in the spring of 1945. The game introduces various new mechanics to the system, such as the leader cards and new combat results. In this game, one player takes control of the Germans and also of the crumbling fascist Italian forces. The Germans, however, have some of their finest units present in this campaign. Strong panzer divisions like the Hermann Goering Panzer Division, several panzer grenadier formations are present as well, and also Fallschirmjäger or parachute divisions. The Allied player, on the other hand, controls a truly multinational force composed of Americans, British, French, Canadians, Poles, Indians, South Africans, Australians, New Zealanders, Greeks, and even Brazilians. The components of the game include three 17-inch by 22-inch mounted map boards. One of the map boards is two-sided, showing the island of Sicily on one side and northern Italy on the other side. The game also includes one player aid map, six two-sided player aid cards, a counter sheet with 88 square-shaped units. Each of these counters measures 1 inch. Another counter sheet with 88 round and 24 hex-shaped counters. Included in the game is a counter depicting an Italian unit that fought with the Allied side, and on its other side appears a photograph of sharpshooter Vincenzo De Ciccio of the 8th Bersaglieri Regiment, taken in late 1943. Vincenzo was the grandfather of Dan Pancaldi, my Canadian friend, gamer, and composer of the music for my videos. The game's designer, Carl Paradis, is Dan's wargaming opponent, and this was a very nice touch indeed. The game also brings 47 event cards. These cards are the heart of the game. Each card shows a German event at the top and an Allied event at the bottom, and various symbols that indicate when the card can be played. The game also includes 8 leader cards. These cards are new to the No Retreat system. Leader cards add special capabilities to each of the sides, based on the abilities of the side's current overall commander. The game includes a 40-page full-color rulebook. The rules for the basic game cover around 37 pages, and there are several advanced rules. The game includes also a 40-page full-color playbook, which contains play balance rules as well as rules applicable to the campaign game. The playbook also shows setup information for the various scenarios included in the game, and also includes player notes for both sides, historical notes, designer notes, and 2 extended examples of play. And finally, the game includes 2 six-sided dice. A word about the Operation Husky example of play found in the playbook. The example was done under an earlier version of the rules, and consequently some of the moves shown in the playbook's example do not comport with the final rules of the game. I will play through the example, making adjustments when necessary to comply with the game's rules. Any rules errors in this video's playthrough are, of course, entirely mine. Here we see the starting forces for the Italians. There's a total of 14 Italian units on the island. Some are static divisions which cannot move. Others are infantry divisions with question marks as combat strengths. Their strengths will be revealed when they enter into a combat situation. And others have a strength of 2. Next, we will place the German units that start on the island in the initial setup. The German units that begin the game are the 15th Panzer Grenadier Division, next to Palermo, and the elite Hermann Goering Panzer Division, which begins occupying an airfield to the southwest of Catania. And in the German reserve box, we place the 29th Panzer Grenadier Division, as well as the reduced 1st Fallschirmjäger or Parachute Division, and one reserve marker at a strength of 2. The Allies draw 2 cards. The first one is Invasion Scare. It has a blue 4-arrowed symbol, meaning it can be played during the strategic phase. And the next card is Italian Auxiliaries, which also can be played during the strategic phase, but because of the British roundel symbol, only in turns where the Allies have the strategic advantage. And at the beginning of the game, the Germans have the strategic advantage. So this card for the Allies is unplayable. So now the Germans pick a card, but before we have to put back the card number 26, which was removed previously. We put it back in the deck. We reshuffle the deck. And the Germans draw 1 card. And it is Soldatenleader. And this has red text, meaning that it has to be implemented immediately. It says reshuffle the deck and discard pile together to form a new draw pile. So we place the card back into the deck. We reshuffle it. And the Germans start the game with no cards. It is important to note that in this scenario, the Allies have, at the beginning, 8 reserve points, while the Germans only have 2, and each reserve point can be used to obtain a free card draw. The weather for the first turn is sunny, and the scenario begins with a free event. Free because no card needs to be played to trigger the event. Because of Operation Husky, the Allied player gets a 3-week major offensive, and because the weather is sunny, that modifies the duration by +1. So it will be 4 weeks of offensives. There's a series of surprise rules for the first turn. The Germans cannot move any units during the deployment phase of the first turn, nor can they use the road movement rate of 1/2 a movement point during the first movement phase. The Germans cannot move any units during the first weekly turn's reserve phase, and neither player can improve or rebuild units during the first organization phase. Now we go to the checks phase. There's nothing to check in terms of victory conditions. Now we're just starting the game. So now we move to the strategic phase. In the strategic phase, both players have to discard down to 2 cards and then draw 4 cards, or they can add reserve points. Next, each of the sides has to discard enough cards to have 2 in their hand. However, the Allies already have 2 and the Germans have no cards. So the next step is for each side to draw 4 cards. And whenever we draw cards, we have to draw them 1 at a time in case we draw a card with red text, which means that that card's effect has to be implemented immediately. So we draw the first card for the allies' naval outflank, and this card can be used during the movement phase or combat phase, as signified by the green arrow and crosshairs, respectively. And the current allied commander, Harold Alexander, has an effect upon this particular drawing of this card. He has a DA ability, which means that he gives the allies the option of keeping the first card drawn or discarding it and drawing another card. However, the allies will keep this card. This is a pretty strong card. And now let's take this opportunity to take a look at what these leader cards bring to the game. You see that Alexander also has another ability, ST, that is that he adds a shock target marker to the allies. And this is used as a target marker to be placed on the enemy units to be attacked, with the added benefit of a one column shift to the right for the allies when they attack. There's a catch to this. These markers have also the possibility of causing additional casualties on the allies. Then you have to the right side a 1 and an R3. The 1 is the penalty and victory points that the allies suffer if Alexander replaces another allied leader. And the R3 is a die roll that that comes into effect when a card like this one is drawn, which has the death head symbol, and a leader replacement check has to be made. A die is rolled, and in the case of Alexander, if it is higher than 3, Alexander is replaced, and depending if it's an even or odd die roll, there's a gain and loss of an event victory point. Finally, in the rectangles you see here, Alexander has special reinforcements that in this case, we're talking about 2 US-British landing markers are not withdrawn if he's the commander, and all units in the Allied destroyed box are put into the reserve box. Note also that Alexander provides a free counterblow marker, as shown by the counterblow symbol on the top left corner of his card. That means that the allies, instead of having to discard one card to be able to use a counterblow marker, they get one for free to be used during the German combat phase as long as Alexander is in command. And leader cards are a new mechanic to the No Retreat series, and each leader has different abilities, and it gives more flavor to the game. So, Alexander for now is in command, and now we will draw the second card for the Allies. So we draw a card, Naval Supremacy. This card has a blue 4-arrowed symbol, meaning it can only be played during the strategic phase or the combat phase, as signified by that crosshaired symbol. The next card, Operation Olive, and this one has a British roundel. It means it can only be played if the Allies have the strategic advantage, and right now it's the Germans that have the strategic advantage, so it's not playable for now. And the fourth card, Alphonse Juin. This one has the German cross, meaning it can only be played when the Germans have the strategic advantage, which they do, and only during the strategic phase. The Allies currently have 6 cards in their hand. That's the maximum allowed. If they would have had less cards after drawing 4, they could have spent reserve points to purchase new card draws. 1 point equals 1 card draw. Now we draw 4 cards for the Germans, one at a time. The first card, Forced Labor. This can only be used during the strategic phase. The second card, Heavy Mortar Attacks. The crosshair symbol means it can only be used during the combat phase, and it can be used to shift an attack one column to the right or left, so it can be used offensively or defensively. Third card, Veteran NCOs, another card that can be used during the combat phase, and also because of that yellow explosion symbol, it can be used to shift to the left a resolution of an allied attrition combat. And the attrition combat is also in the advanced rules, but highly recommended to be used. The fourth card, Occupied Territory. This card has to be implemented immediately. The card has to be given to the allies, and a replacement card is drawn, and then a die is rolled. On the even result, one reserve point is lost. Odd result, a unit from the garrison box, the OB Sud garrison box, has to be placed in the reserve box. So this card is given to the allies, and the Germans draw a replacement card, Republic of Salo. And this can only be used if the allies have the strategic advantage, which they don't. So it's not much worth to the Germans. And now a die is rolled, and the result is a 3. Because the result is odd, a unit from the OB Sud garrison box is placed in the reserve box. This event is ignored because the units in the OB Sud garrison box are not used in this scenario. But if you would be playing a campaign game, they would be placed here and moved to the German reserves box. The Allies had 6 cards, and they received one more from the Germans, Operation Shingle, which, by the way, can be played because the Germans have the strategic advantage. However, the Allies now have 7 cards, and the next step in the strategic phase is the part where each of the sides plays cards. If the Allies play no cards at all during the remainder of the strategic phase, we will move into each of the players' turns, starting with the Allies, and the Allies will then be forced to randomly discard one of their cards. But for now, they have 7 cards, and now each of the sides plays cards during the strategic phase. So now each of the sides alternates playing cards, and we start with the Allies. The Allies will play this card, Alphonse Juin. Note that there are no French units in the game, so this card will have no effect, but at the end of the instructions, it says that the Allies draw a new card. So this card goes to the discard pile, and the Allies draw a new card, Commando Raids, which can be played during the Allied movement phase. Now it's the Germans' turn to play a card, but they decide to pass. Now it's the Allies' turn to play a card. They still have 7 cards. They just drew one. And note that this Invasion Scare card could be played, but it would actually help the Germans by placing more units on the beach when the Allies are about to invade. So the Allies also pass, and with 2 consecutive passes, the strategic phase is over. And now we move on to the organization phase, and we consult the game turn track, and we notice that the Germans receive 2 blitz markers and the Allies 3 shock markers. And note that because the weather is sunny, the Allies would receive an additional shock marker, but because the Germans control the airfield next to Siracusa, the Allies have no cover on the Sicilia map, and therefore they suffer a penalty of 1 less shock marker. So in other words, this penalty cancels the additional shock marker the Allies would receive for the sunny weather. Next, in the organization phase, we improve units, but because of the surprise rule, that doesn't happen. And next, we would rebuild shattered and eliminated units, but there are none. There are no reinforcements and no withdrawals that take place. Now we go to the deployment phase. Note that the Germans cannot move any of their units into or out of their reserve box. And that's because of the first turn surprise rule of this scenario. The Allies cannot move any of their units onto the map because they don't control any hexes on the map yet. The Allies can move landings markers into 2 landing zones on the map. They could move all 7 markers that they have. What they will do is they will place 6 markers on the map. They will leave one for future use with this naval outflank card that they have. The rules limit the number of landing zones that can be invaded during the same turn at 2, and a landing zone is a group of adjacent hexes with landing arrows. So this is one landing zone, and this is another landing zone. And landings markers are placed one per arrow in each hex, and each of these hexes that we place them has one arrow. So we've placed 6 landings markers in 2 landing zones. These landings markers are like stepping stones, which allow units to move from the reserves box to the landing zone hexes at a cost of 3 movement points. Now we go to the allied turn, and the first phase for the allies is the supply phase, and there are no units that are out of supply. So the next step would be the allied movement phase. And now the allies, because they have 7 cards in their hand, one above the maximum, they have to randomly discard one card. So we shuffle the deck and we discard one card, and it is naval supremacy. And this is a real hard blow for the allies, because this is a pretty powerful card. So out it goes. And the card goes to the discard pile. Now the allies move their units from their reserves box, which are these 2 boxes here, to the map, and that is specifically to the landing zone hexes with landings markers. So 3 American divisions are placed in the landing zone in front of Jela. And we see the 3rd U.S. Infantry Division, the 1st Mechanized Division, and the 9th Infantry Division placed there. Now, these units have to be placed in landing zones because they're regular units. The Americans have a Ranger unit, which in game terms is treated as a commando unit, which have the advantage that they don't have to be placed in landing arrowed hexes. So they can be placed directly into a coastal hex, and we place the unit there. Now we place the British units that will be placed on landings markers in the landing zone near Syracuse. And we place the British infantry divisions, as well as the Canadian mechanized infantry division, on landing zone hexes. And the British also have their commando unit, which does not have to be placed in one of those hexes. It can be directly placed in a coastline hex, and we will place it here in this coastal hex adjacent to Syracuse. In addition to the units that have been placed in landing zones, the Allies have an airborne unit, which is this unit from the 82nd Airborne Division that is now airdropped. During an invasion turn, an Allied parachute unit may be dropped within 3 hexes of a landing zone that has a landings marker, but not on top of an enemy unit. So the Allies will drop the 82nd Airborne here next to that Italian division. This is a para drop, which occurs in the enemy zone of control and also outside of air cover. So for any of those 2 reasons, this is what is called an opposed para drop. We consult the opposed para drop table. On a German cross result, the unit goes to the shattered box, a British roundel, and it's a safe landing. Any other result, 1 step loss. So we draw a card, consult the allied result, extreme temperature. We do not apply the event there. We note that it does not have a roundel or a German cross, so the result is that the 82nd loses 1 step. And we flip the unit to its reduced side. Now the Allies move their units and they must stop upon entering an enemy zone of control, and those that are in enemy zones of control to begin with can't move. Here's the movement of the American units in front of Jilla. The only unit being able to move was the 3rd Infantry Division. And here we see the movements in the British landing zone. The only unit able to move is the 1st Canadian Division. The combat phase begins by the Allies, who are the facing side, declaring their attacks. And they will declare 4 attacks and will place a target marker on each hex that will be attacked. So it's 2 attacks in the area around Jilla and 2 in the area around Siracusa. Note that Alexander's ability ST means that he provides a shock target marker to the Allies that can be also placed, but the Allies decide not to use this marker. Being a shock target marker, it has the potential of causing heavy casualties on the Allied side. Next, the opposing player, the Germans, play any counterblow markers. And counterblow markers are played on one's units to force the enemy to attack them at unfavorable odds. The Germans have as their commander Kesselring, and you see on his top left-hand corner 2 symbols. The first one is counterblow shock marker, and the other one is a regular counterblow marker. This means that Kesselring causes that the Germans can play both of these markers without having to discard any cards. And now they will choose to play the shock counterblow marker on one of their units to force the Allies to attack it at unfavorable odds. And the markers placed on the Italian unit adjacent to the 82nd Airborne, forcing the Americans to attack the Italians. Now, combat resolution is performed in the order that is chosen by the phasing player. So the Allies choose which battles will be resolved first, and they choose to resolve the battle involving the 9th U.S. Infantry Division against a static Italian unit to the east of Jilla. So we start by flipping the static unit to its known strength side. And it is a 0 strength unit. 0 strength units are always attacked on the 6-1 plus column, irrespective of the strength of the attacking units. So we locate the 6-1 plus column on the Allied combat results table. None of the sides will play any shock or blitz markers or any combat event cards because it will not alter the column in which this combat is resolved. 0 units are always attacked at that 6-1 plus column. So we roll 1d6. The result is a 3, defender shattered. In a defender shattered result, a defender has to retreat his units 2 hexes, and if they're not destroyed for failure to retreat, they are then placed in the shattered units box, and from there they can return to the game later on. After that, the attacking units can advance. However, in this particular case, the defending unit is a static unit. Static units cannot retreat. So if called on to retreat, they are eliminated. So we remove the static unit from the map, but instead of placing it in the destroyed unit box, because it is an eliminated Italian fascist unit, it goes back into the Italian draw cup. Now the 9th U.S. Infantry advances 2 hexes, and the first hex always is the hex vacated by the defending unit, and it advances 1 more hex. And now we proceed to resolve the combat against the static Italian unit to the west of Jilla. We start by flipping the Italian unit to its known strength side. Has a strength of 1, 11 factors against 1, we start at the 6-1 plus column. Note that the defending unit is in a beach hex, and if the U.S. 1st Mechanized Infantry were attacking it by itself, that defender would receive a 1 column shift to the left because of the beach hex. But because the 3rd U.S. is attacking from an adjacent non-landing zone hex, that the column shift does not apply. And note also that the river hex side for the Salso River does not give the defenders any plus one column shift to the left, because the first U.S. mechanized unit does not have similarly a river hex side between itself and the Italians. So we resolve this attack on the 6-1 plus column. None of the sides play any combat support markers, that is shock or blitz markers, nor any combat event cards, so we roll 1d6. The result is a 6, a red DD, defender destroyed. So the Italian unit is eliminated, and again, because it is an Italian fascist unit, it goes to the Italian draw cup. And now we advance first the 3rd U.S. Infantry, 2 hexes. It occupies the vacated hex and advances 1 more hex. Now, as to the 1st U.S. mechanized unit, being a mechanized unit gives it a choice here. The result was a red defender eliminated result, so he has 2 choices. He could advance 3 hexes or advance 2 hexes and attack an adjacent enemy unit, and that is what it will do. It advances into the vacated hex, the beach hex, which is a non-stopping terrain hex, and continues its advance into a hills hex adjacent to the Italian infantry unit in the mountains. And hills is also a non-stopping hex, and that allows the 1st U.S. mechanized unit to engage in what is called second combat. And second combat is a second attack that it can conduct, but it is resolved after all initial attacks are resolved. And we still have to resolve the attacks near Siracusa and the counterblow battle involving the 82nd Airborne Division. Now we proceed to the counterblow battle, where the 82nd Airborne attacks the Italian infantry unit. Note that the Italian infantry is in mountainous terrain, which normally gives the defenders 2 column shifts to the left. However, one particularity of counterblow battles is that there are no terrain modifiers for the hex where the defenders are located. So this is a 2-2 attack, or 1-1 odds. And there is a column shift to the left, just 1 column shift to the left on account of the counterblow shock marker. The shock effect gives the Italians 1 column shift to the left, so we are at 1-2. Now each of the sides decides whether to use any support markers, that is for the Germans or Axis blitz markers, and for the Allies shock markers, and the Allies will use 1 shock marker. And the shock marker shifts the odds column now from 1-2 back to 1-1. So it cancels the shock effect of the counterblow shock marker. And no combat event cards are played, so we roll 1d6 on the 1-1 column of the Allied combat results table. And the result is a 2 CA counter attack. In a counterattack, the defenders can do 1 of 2 things. They can launch an immediate counterattack, in which case a new battle sequence is started and the terrain that the new defender is occupying, which would be the 82nd Airborne, is not taken into consideration. The second option they can do is just do nothing and the battle ends right there. And the Italians decide to launch an immediate counterattack. So we remove the original shock and counterblow shock markers, and we start a new battle sequence, 2 attacking Italian factors against 2 defending American factors, that is 1-1. Now we see if any of the sides plays any combat support markers. The Axis will play 1 of their blitz markers, and the blitz marker is used by the Axis to shift the odds ratio from 1-1 to the next column to the right, 3-2. We locate the 3-2 column on the German combat results table. None of the sides will play any combat event cards. We roll 1d6. And the result is a 2, a dash, that is an indecisive battle. In other words, no effect. And so the battle between the 82nd Airborne and the Italians ends in no effect, and both units stay as they are and where they are. And we remove the used blitz marker. Okay, we resolve the counterblow battle. We don't go yet into resolving the second combat, but we move east to resolve the two initial attacks that are set forth there near Siracusa. And we will resolve first the attack on the static Italian unit in the beach to the southeast of Siracusa. We start by revealing the strength of the static unit. It is a unit with a strength of 2, and we have 3 British units attacking the Italians, a total of 14 combat factors against 2. That would normally be 7-1, but the rightmost column is the 6-1 plus column, and that's where we start. And note that the one column shift to the left for the Italians being on a beach hex does not apply, because not all attackers are attacking from landing zone hexes. The 1st Canadian nullifies that column shift. No combat support markers or event cards are played. We roll 1d6. The roll is a 3, DS, Defender, Shattered. In a DS result, the Defender retreats his unit's 2 hexes, and if not eliminated during the retreat, the units are placed in the Shattered Units box. However, this is an Italian fascist unit. A static unit, it can retreat 2 hexes. And we take the unit and place it in the Italian draw cup. Now we advance the victorious units. The 1st Canadian moves into the vacated hex, and then one hex to the west, adjacent to the Italian infantry unit. The 46th occupies a vacated hex and moves one hex towards Siracusa. The British 5th does the same. Now we proceed to resolve the commando attack against Siracusa, where there is an unknown strength Italian infantry division, which we now reveal. And the Italians have a combat strength of a black 1. So we start with 2 combat factors attacking, 1 defending, 2-1. And there's a 1 column shift to the left because the defenders are in a port hex. So now we're at 3-2. And the Allies decide to play one of their 2 remaining shock markers, which increases the odds from 3-2 back to 2-1. No combat event cards are played, so we roll 1d6 on the 2-1 column. The result is a 6, a red DR or defender retreat result. In a DR result, defender retreats. The defender has an option. If his combat factor is black, it can retreat 2 hexes, in which case Siracusa would fall to the Allies because the paratroopers or the commandos would be able to advance into it. Or it has the option of taking a step loss because it is a black combat factor unit. But because it is a DR result, that step loss would eliminate the Italians, because that Italian unit is a one-step unit, and the attacking commandos could still advance into Siracusa. So now the Germans play this card, Heavy Mortar Attacks, which is played during the battle sequence after the die is rolled, and it shifts the odds ratio column, one column to the left or to the right. So the attack was resolved on the 2-1 column with this red DR result, which allows the Allies to advance into the hex anyways, be it a retreat by the Italians or taking one step of losses, which eliminates the Italian unit. So with the card played, now the odds ratio is shifted to the 3-2 column. And the result now is a red D result. Defender falls back. Here, the defender can either retreat 2 hexes or not retreat and take a step loss if the defending unit has a black combat factor. And if they do that, if they take the step loss, the attacking units cannot advance. So the Italians will take the step loss option, and we remove the Italian infantry from the map and place it in the Italian draw cup. And the British commandos stay where they are. They cannot enter Siracusa. Having resolved all initial attacks, now we move back to the American sector to resolve the second combat between the 1st American Mechanized Division and the Italian infantry defending in the mountains. And here we see that the attackers have 6 combat factors, the defenders 2, so it is 3-1, but the defenders are in a mountain hex, and that provides 2 column shifts to the left. So we move from 3-1 to the 3-2 column. Each side has 1 combat support marker left, so they will play none here, and they will play no combat event card. So we roll 1d6, and the result is a 6, a red D. A red defender falls back. Again, the defender can retreat his unit 2 hexes or not retreat and lose 1 step if the defender has a black combat strength. And in that case, the attacking units can only advance if the defender retreated. They cannot if the defender took the step loss. If the Italians decide to retreat, it would be a 2 hex retreat. All retreats in this game are 2 hex retreats, which means that the Italians would end up in one of these hexes. And then the Americans would be able to advance 2 hexes, but because the potentially vacated hex is a mountain hex, that is stopping terrain, they would have to stop their advance there. So the Italians don't want to give up that valuable mountain position, so they choose the option of taking a step loss, and we flip the Italian unit to its reduced side. And the Italian unit now has a white combat strength of 1. And it is now what is called a brittle unit, as signified by that white combat factor. Brittle units cannot take step losses to cancel retreats. And that ends the combat here. The Americans fail to advance into the mountainous hex. And that ends the Allied combat phase. And note that it's not all peaches and cream. They failed to take Siracusa, failed to dislodge the Italians from that mountain range, which is northwest of Gela. And Axis still have available their 2 most powerful units nearby, the 15th Panzer Grenadier Division, as well as the Hermann Goering Panzer Division. And now we proceed to the Allied reserve phase, and in this phase, the Allied player can move units from his reserves box onto supplied hexes on the map. And the Allies will pick the 2nd Armor Division, and it is placed in one of the hexes of the American landing zone, which has a landings marker. And the 45th U.S. Infantry Division will stay in the reserves box. It will not be moved onto the map at this time, and that is because of supply constraints that we will see later. Now we check for British units that may move onto the map. The British 23rd Tank Unit, as well as the 78th Infantry Division, will be placed on the map. And we place each unit in a landings hex in the British landing zone, occupied by a landings marker. And note that the British still have 3 more units that for now stay in the Allied reserves box, and this is because of supply constraints. The next step in this reserve phase is to move the landings markers to the beaches and flip them to become beachhead markers. Let's first show all the landings markers at this time. And here we see 6 landings markers, three in the American and three in the British landing zones. And now we move them to their respective beaches. And now we flip them to their beachhead marker side. And now we'll place this beachhead marker underneath these two British units. Now we move on to the German player turn, and the first phase in the German turn is the German supply phase. But don't be misled by the title. Supply is checked for both sides during each of the sides' supply phases. So we check supply for the Allies and the Germans during the German supply phase. And let's check supply first for the Allies. We have 12 supply points provided by the beachhead markers. These three units consume 4 supply points, and these three units consume 4 more supply points for a total of 8. Note that the Ranger unit here is a commando unit in a coastal hex, so it does not consume any of the beachhead supply points, and the same happens to the British commando unit. It is in a coastal hex and does not consume any of the beachhead supply points. Note also that the units that are in landing zones are not counted against the supply capacity of the beachhead marker. So the Allies of the 12 supply points that the beachhead markers are supplying are consuming 8. And finally, note that the 82nd Airborne is considered to be in supply the first turn when it airdrops. So it is not counted towards the supply capacity of the beachhead markers. And now we move on to the German movement phase, and there's a special surprise rule that applies to the German movement phase. The Germans cannot use the road movement bonus during their first turn, and that applies now. So the Germans will move the 15th Panzergrenadier Division. And note the importance of the road movement bonus. If there would be a road movement bonus, this unit could easily reach this position here and attack the American Rangers on the beach. However, because there is no movement bonus provided by the road, to get to this hex, it would move 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 movement points to reach this hex, but it could not enter this hex because it is in an enemy zone of control, and it would have to pay 1 more movement factor, and it only has 6. It would need 7 to get here. Therefore, the 15th Panzergrenadiers will move 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 movement factors, their full movement allowance, to take up this mountain position overlooking the Rangers. Further to the west, we see an Italian infantry unit with an unknown strength. This is a mobile infantry unit with a movement factor of 4, even though it's not printed on the counter. It will move 1, 2, 3, 4 into the mountains and next to the Platani River in the proximity of the American Ranger unit. Next, we look at the situation with the Italian division that recently engaged in combat against the American 82nd. Note that the Axis could leave that division there, but in this game, the counterblow markers present the player with unique challenges. By leaving your units adjacent to enemy units, the enemy may play counterblow markers, forcing the weak Italians to attack strong Allied units like the 1st U.S. So the Italians instead decide to move away from the 1st U.S. mechanized unit into this mountain hex, but they cannot move directly from an enemy zone of control to another enemy zone of control hex. So they move here, 1 movement point, spend 2 more for a total of 3, plus 1 more because it's in an enemy zone of control for a total of 4 to enter the mountain hex adjacent only to the 82nd Airborne. Now the Hermann Goering Panzer Division, which is currently occupied this valuable hex here, this airfield hex, will move one hex southwest to enter this mountain hex, expending two for the mountain hex plus one for entering a zone of control for a total of three movement points. And moving to the east, we note the situation of this Italian infantry unit is currently adjacent to the 1st Canadian Motorized Division. It cannot reach this hex because it would need five movement factors, 1, 2, 3, 4 plus the zone of control, 5, and the Italian fascist units only have 4 movement factors. And also, by reaching this hex, it would be susceptible to a counterblow attack against 8 British combat factors, so it will stay in its current hex for now. And now we proceed to the German combat phase, and we start by placing German target markers on those Allied hexes that they will attack, and a target marker is placed here on top of the 82nd Airborne Unit. The Germans place no more target markers, so now the Allies decide if they will place any counterblow markers. Note that there are not many hexes occupied by Axis units, which are adjacent to Allied units, and those would be the hexes that are susceptible to counterblows. Note that we have here this Italian unit, which is adjacent to the Canadian division, so a counterblow marker could be placed on the Canadians to force the Italians to make that less than hopeful attack there. And notice that counterblow markers cannot be placed on hexes which already have target markers. Now the Allies have as their commander Alexander, and note that on the top left corner of his card there's a counterblow symbol, so he provides a free counterblow marker to the Allies. The Allies place the counterblow marker on top of the 1st Canadian Division to force the Italians in the mountains to attack them. Since we are in the German combat phase, the Germans decide the order in which the battles will be resolved, and they decide to resolve first the counterblow battle to the south of Siracusa. So we have two attacking Italian factors against 6 Canadian defending factors, 2 against 6, or 1 to 3. And 1 to 3 is the leftmost column on both combat results tables. It's the worst column to attack any unit on. So now we roll 1d6 because none of the sides will play any support markers or combat event cards. The result is a 3CA counterattack. That means that the Allies may make an immediate counterattack or end the combat situation right now. And the Allies decide to make an immediate counterattack. So it's 6 Canadian factors against 2 Italian factors, 3-1. And remember that in counterattacks, the defending unit's hex is not counted for any terrain column shifts. No combat support nor combat event cards are played, so we roll 1 die on the 3-1 column. And the die roll is a 3, and exchanged, followed by a required counterattack by the defending unit. And with the exchange result, which we apply first, each side loses one step, so we flip the units from each of the sides to their reduced strengths. And now the Italians have a white 1, and the Canadians have 4 combat factors, and they are not mechanized anymore, nor do they consume extra supplies for now. Now we apply the required counterattack result. In a required counterattack result, the defender must either launch an immediate counterattack or suffer a D result. In a D result, the defending unit must retreat 2 hexes or take a step loss if it is a combat unit with a black combat factor, but this unit is now a brittle combat unit, so the Italians don't have the option of taking a step loss to avoid retreat, so they decide to retreat 2 hexes and not launch the immediate counterattack. So the Italians will retreat in a northwesterly direction into a mountain hex and then end their retreat on a hills hex next to the airfield. Now the victorious Canadians can advance two hexes, but note that they must enter first the vacated hex, which is a mountain hex and which stops any further advance. So that's the end of that battle. And now we move west to proceed to resolve the battle between the Hermann Goering Panzer Division and the reduced American 82nd Airborne. So note that the Italians can also join in the attack. So we have 8 Axis factors against 2 Allied factors, that is 4-1. There is a 2-column shift to the left because the Americans are mountain terrain, so now we're at 2-1. And the Germans will use their last combat support marker, this Blitz marker, to increase the odds from 2-1 now to 3-1. The Allies will not play their last shark marker, nor any of the sides play any combat event card, so we roll 1d6 on the German 3-1 column. And the result is a 6, a red defender shattered result. So the defenders retreat 2 hexes, and if they are not destroyed for failure to retreat, they are placed in the shattered units box. In this case, the 82nd Airborne, which is already reduced, retreats 2 hexes towards Jela. So it was able to complete its retreat, and now we pick the unit and place it in the shattered units box. Note that shattered units are not eliminated and they return to the game at no cost in replacement points. Now we proceed to the German reserves phase, and because of the special surprise rule that applies to this scenario, no German units are brought from the reserves onto the map during the first weekly turn. Now we proceed to the first major offensive continuation, and we move the weak marker from the number 4 to the number 3 box. That means we're going to play now our second weekly turn, and any unused support markers, shock or blitz markers, are considered spent. Now we move on to the first weekly event draw segment, where each of the players draws one card and the Allied player draws a card first, and it is Medal of Honor Wearers, and this can be played anytime during a battle sequence to reroll a single die or change the result to an automatic exchange. Now with this new card, the Allies now have a total of 7 cards, and if things stand as they are at the beginning of the movement phase, they will have to shuffle their cards and randomly remove one of them. So now the Germans draw a card. Rough weather. It has red text, so we have to implement it immediately. It says immediately discard this card. Play if in the strategic phase. We're not in the strategic phase, so the black text is ignored, and we have to discard this card. So the Germans, who are very short on cards right now, spend one of their reserve points to purchase one card draw. So we flip the reserve marker now to the number 1 side, and the Germans draw another card, Panzerstellung, and this card can be played during the strategic phase or a battle sequence, but it involves forts, and there are no forts in this game until turn number 4, so for now the only value this card will have will be for its discard value, so we add this card to the German hand. Now we move on to the weekly organization segment. Here each of the sides receives the same number of support markers that they received at the beginning of the turn. The Germans receive 2 blitz markers, and the allies 3 shock markers. Now we proceed to improve units, starting with the allies, and the allies will play this card, Operation Olive, which is basically useless for now for the event. Note that it has a British roundel, meaning that the British have to have the strategic initiative, and right now it's the Germans who have it, so we can only play it for its discard value, and it has a discard value of 2 cards. So discarding this one is like discarding 2 cards, so we discard this card to rebuild units either in the reserves box or on the map. One discard is used to flip the reduced 1st Canadian Infantry unit to its full strength mechanized side, and note that in order to rebuild units on the map, they have to be in supply, and the 1st Canadian can trace a line of supply to the beachhead markers, and the line of supply cannot be more than 4 hexes there, and it can easily do so. The allies have 1 discard left, and there's another reduced unit on the map, which is the American Rangers. However, being a commando unit, this unit requires 2 discards to flip it back to full strength, so no more units will be rebuilt at this time, and the extra discard is lost. Now it's a German's turn to rebuild units, and they will play this card, Forced Labor, not for its event there, but for its discard value of 2 cards. And it will be played to rebuild the 2 Italian units that were reduced in combat, shown here, and we flip them now to their full strength sides. Now we move shattered units from the shattered units box, specifically the 82nd Airborne, to the Allied Reserves box, and we leave it with its reduced side showing, and we place a no combat marker on the unit to remind us that it cannot engage in combat this turn because it is being rebuilt. Note that the Allies could have used any of their cards for its discard value in order to remove the rebuilt no combat marker from the parachute unit, but the Allies decide that the unit is still in a very weakened state, and they will not use a card for that purpose now. Now we proceed to the Allied supply phase, where we check supply for all units, and note that the Allies have a capacity of 12 supply points, 2 for each beachhead hex, and they're about to receive new units that once they land on the island will be counted against that supply capacity. And we're talking about the 78th British and the 23rd British tank units, plus the 2nd US Armored Division. Note that all Axis units are in supply. The Italian fascist units can trace a line of supply of 4 hexes to any city here. And imagine if this unit were to trace a line of supply to Palermo. It could, because it can trace it within 4 hexes to a road that leads to a city. The Germans, they trace supply to the northern edge of the map, and they would do so in the same way, tracing it to a road that leads to the northern end. So all Axis units are in supply. Now we go to the Allied movement phase, and remember that we're in the second week of this game turn. We already played the first week. We're in the second week, and the full game turn has 2 more additional weeks. And we will begin the movement phase by moving the units near the British landing zone. We begin by moving the 5th British Infantry Division with a movement allowance of 6, 2 movement points to enter the Mountain Hex, plus 3 additional movement points, 2 for the Mountain Hex and 1 for the Italian Zone of Control. That is 5, and it stops movement there. Next, the 46th Infantry Division spends 2 movement points to move into the mountains and 2 additional movement points to enter the clear hex adjacent to 2 Italian units, and the zones of control stop any further movement. Next, British commandos enter Siracusa, and they have to stop because they're in an enemy zone of control. The entry into Siracusa has several effects. We move the Italian war status track marker to the next box to the left, to the Finito Benito space. Where the marker is has profound effects on the Italian war effort. If the marker is at the Viva il Re space when the check is performed, then all Italian fascist units can no longer conduct voluntary attacks. If the marker is at the Armisticio space, then the German player has to move all of his units off the Sicilia map, and any units not in supply go to the shattered box, and all Italian fascist units cannot voluntarily attack nor move. And the capture of Siracusa has additional effects. You can see two small boxes containing the number one, a gray box and a green box. This is the amount of reserve points that the capture of the city generates for the Allies in green and also for the Germans. And you may be asking, why are the Germans, who are losing a city, getting reserve points? And what this reflects is that the capture of this important city has called the attention of the German High Command, and the German High Command is sending more resources to this front. So we would add one reserve point to the Allies, but they're already maxed out at 8, 4 for the Americans and 4 for the British. So that gain of a reserve point is ignored. The Germans, on the other hand, have one reserve point. They're not maxed out. So we flip the reserve marker from its number one side to reflect that the Germans now have two reserve points. The 78th British Infantry Division pays two movement points to enter the beach hex, and that is one movement point for the hex and one for the beachhead marker, which adds to the cost, and two more movement points to enter Siracusa. That's one movement point for the port hex plus one movement point for moving into an enemy zone of control. Note that the unit could not use the road movement bonus from the beachhead hex to the port because invading units cannot use the road movement rate on the turn in which they're invading. Now the 23rd tank moves onto the beachhead, spending two movement points, two more to enter the next beachhead space to the northwest. And having spent four movement points, it spends its last two movement points to enter Siracusa. Note that there are now three British units there. Stacking limits are two regular units. Commando units do not count for stacking purposes. Now we see the movement of the 1st Canadian Motorized Division. It spends three movement points to enter the hex occupied by the 5th British Infantry Division, which is a mountain hex, and three movement points. It's because it's two for the mountains and one for the enemy zone of control, and it stops there and ends its movement. Now we conduct movement for the American units near the American landing zone. The 2nd Armored moves onto the beachhead, spending two movement points, a third to move into this open hex, and two movement points to move into the hills next to the 15th Panzer Grenadiers. And now the Ranger unit will move. It spends one movement point to enter this open hex adjacent to the German unit. And regularly entering an enemy zone of control causes the unit to stop movement. But now the Allies play this card, Commando Raids, which allows the Rangers to move directly from one enemy zone of control to another enemy zone of control hex. So the Rangers now spend two movement points to cross the river and move onto the hill hex to the west of the 15th Panzer Grenadiers and ending their move there. Next, the 1st U.S. Mechanized Division moves to a mountain hex adjacent to an Italian infantry division and has to stop. And now the 3rd U.S. Infantry Division spends one movement point and then two more to cross the Salsa River and move adjacent to the 15th Panzer Grenadier Division. And lastly, the U.S. 9th Infantry Division moves into hill terrain adjacent to the Hermann Goering Panzer Division and ends its movement phase. Now, apparently, the Allies have finished their movement phase, but they are not done yet. The Allies now play this card, Naval Outflank, which can be played during the movement phase to make a one-unit invasion on a beachhead that is not more than 3 hexes from an Allied unit. And where would that be? Well, the Allies have a beachhead which is not more than 3 hexes from the Allied units that just captured Siracusa. And we're specifically referring to this landing zone hex. To place a unit on that landing zone hex, the Allies have to have an available landings marker, and they have one in their reserves box, which they will use now. So the landings marker is placed on the landing zone hex to the east of Catania. That allows the Allies to bring the British 51st Highlander Infantry Division into that landings hex. And now the Allies finish their movement phase, and now we proceed to the Allied combat phase. And now the Allies go for broke and will use all of their 5 target markers, 4 regular target markers, and 1, which is a target shock marker. And they are placed on top of the hexes that will be attacked. So we see attacks on the Italians at Catania, the static Italian unit defending the beach to the northwest of Siracusa, the Italians near the airport, as well as the Italians in the mountain range next to the Hermann Goering Panzer Division, and finally the 15th Panzer Grenadier Division, which is surrounded. Note that the Hermann Goering Panzer Division is not being attacked. Now the Germans declare if they will place any counterblow markers, and remember they have a free counterblow and a free counterblow shock marker which they can use, and they will place the counterblow shock marker on top of the Hermann Goering Panzer Division that will force the 9th U.S. Infantry Division to attack it. And now the phasing side, the Allies decide the order in which the battles will be resolved. And the first battle to be resolved will be the attack on the surrounded 15th Panzer Grenadiers. 13 attacking factors against 6 defending factors, that is 2-1. The Germans, however, are occupying mountainous terrain, which shifts the attack 2 columns to the left, so we're now at 1-1. However, there is a target shock marker, and the shock effect moves the odds 1 column to the right, so we're now at 3-2. And the Allies decide to use one of their 3 shock markers, which shifts the odds 1 column to the right, and now we're at 2-1. Now the Germans announce that they will use their tenacity defense bonus. You see that the 15th Panzer Grenadier unit has a red combat factor. It has a tenacious defense ability, which when used, shifts the odds 1 column to the left. So now we would be back to 3-2. The downside for the Germans is that on a result of a defender falls back or defender retreats, the German unit cannot retreat and has to take a step loss. No combat cards are played. We roll 1d6 on the 3-2 column. The result is a 5 exchange followed by a required counterattack. The exchange result will cause 1 step of losses for each of the sides. The Germans are not pleased with this combat result, so now they will play this card, Veteran NCOs, that allows them to reroll the combat resolution die roll. So we roll the die once again. This time the result is a 6, a red D. Defender falls back. So the defender has to either retreat his unit 2 hexes or not retreat and take a 1-step loss. And in this situation, because the defending unit used its tenacious defense ability, it has to suffer the step loss anyway. So instead of retreating, we reduce it by flipping the unit to its backside. And now the allies, because they use their target shock marker, have to sustain 1-step loss, and they'll take it from the 3rd U.S. Infantry Division, which we also flip to its reduced side, ending that combat situation. Next, the Allies decide to resolve the attack by the 1st U.S. Mechanized Division on the Italian unit in mountain terrain. 6 attacking factors against 2 defending Italian factors. That is 3-1. The Italians are in a mountain hex, so we shift the odds 2 columns to the left, so we are at 3-2. And the Allies use their 2nd shock mark. And now the odds column that will be used will be the 2-1 column, and none of the sides play any combat event cards. So we roll 1d6 on the 2-1 column. The result is a 3 in exchange. Both sides lose a step and neither side retreats or advances. So each side loses a step and we flip both units to their reduced sides, and that ends that combat situation, and the Italians are still holding out in the mountains. Now we move on to the battle between the Canadians and British against the Italians near the airfield. 3 British and Canadian units, 14 combat factors, attacking the Italians with 2. That would normally be a 7-1 odds, but the rightmost column in the combat results table is 6-1 plus, so we start there. And note that there's a 1 column shift to the left because the Italians are occupying hill terrain, so we move now to the 5-1 column. None of the sides use any support markers nor combat event cards, so we roll 1d6. The result is a 6, a red DD, defender destroyed. The defender retreats his unit's 2 hexes, and then each defending unit loses a step, and the attacking units can then advance. So the defending Italian unit retreats 2 hexes, and now takes a step loss, and we flip the unit to its reduced side. Now the victorious units can advance 2 hexes, with the exception of the 1st Canadian Division, which can advance 3 hexes because it is a motorized unit, and this was a red DD result. The only thing that will stop it from advancing 3 hexes is any stopping terrain it encounters along the way. The 46th British Infantry advances into the vacated hex and advances 1 more hex adjacent to the retreating Italians. Now the 1st Canadian Motorized Infantry advances into the vacated hex and advances into the airfield hex, but it can advance no further because it crossed a river hexside, and the river hexside is stopping terrain, so it cannot advance beyond that hex. The capture of the airfield has an effect on reserve points. There's a 0 for German reserve points, but the Allies receive 1 reserve point. The problem for the Allies is, as we saw a little while ago, they are maxed out at 8, so that reserve point is ignored. And finally, the 5th British Infantry Division occupies a vacated hex and advances 1 more hex into the mountain hex adjacent to the Hermann Goering Panzer Division. Next, we resolve the British attack against Catania, and we reveal the strength of the Italian static unit. It has a strength of 1, 3 against 1, a 3-1 attack, and there's a 1 column shift to the left because the defenders are in a port hex, so now we're at 2-1. And the Allies use their last shock marker to increase the odds back to 3-1. No combat cards are played at this time. We roll 1d6. The result is a 3 exchange followed by a required counterattack. The exchange would definitely eliminate the static Italian unit, but would cause the British unit to suffer a step loss. So the Allied player now plays this card, Medal of Honor Wearers, that allows the Allies to reroll the combat resolution die. So we roll the die once again. The result is a 1 counter blow. If the final combat result table shift was to the right, in this case it wasn't. This was an original 3-1 attack in which the shock marker canceled the port 1 column shift to the left. So that doesn't apply, but it says, or if the attacker played a combat card, which the attacker did, now we roll 1 die on the CB column. And where is the CB column? It is here, the rightmost column of the combat results table. And we roll 1d6. The result is a 2FB, final counter blow. So the attacker, in this case, the Allied player, places a counter blow marker on one of the phasing player's occupied hexes. The Allies decide to place the counter blow marker on top of the 51st Highlander Division to force the Italians with their static division to attack it in the next turn. Note that the static division cannot move away and avoid attacking the 51st because static divisions cannot move at all. Next, we proceed to resolve the battle near Siracusa between 3 Allied units and an Italian static division on the beach. We reveal the strength of the static unit. It's a 0 strength unit, so irrespective of the combat factors of the attacking units, this will be a 6-1 plus attack. No combat support markers are played, no combat event cards, and there are no terrain effect modifiers that apply in attacks against 0 strength units, so we roll 1d6. The result is a 3, a black defense shattered result. In a defense shattered result, the defender first retreats 2 hexes, and if not eliminated during the retreat, it is then placed in the shattered units box, and it could return later to the game. But the case with this static unit is that it cannot retreat, so it is eliminated and placed in the Italian draw cup. The British 23rd Tank Brigade advances 2 hexes to this hex here adjacent to Catania. And the 78th British Infantry does the same. And the British commando unit stays in the port of Siracusa. Now we move on to resolve the counterblow battle involving the Hermann Goering Panzer Division and the U.S. 9th Infantry Division. In this situation, the 9th U.S. has to attack the Hermann Goering Panzer Division, and we begin with 5 against 7, that is 1-2 odds. The Germans benefit from the shock effect of the counterblow shock marker, and therefore the odds are shifted 1 column to the left, and now the attack is 1-3. No combat support markers are used, nor any combat event cards. Reroll 1d6. The result is a 2 counterattack. The defender, the German, may launch an immediate counterattack, and if they do, we begin a new battle sequence with no terrain modifiers. The Germans, sensing that they are being surrounded, will execute an immediate counterattack against the 9th U.S. Infantry, so we begin a new battle sequence and we remove the counterblow shock marker. 7 against 5, that is 1-1. The Germans get a 1 column shift to the right because of the armor bonus. Notice that the defending unit is in hills, and that terrain gives the attacking Germans the armor bonus with their panzer division. So the attack is now at the 3-2 column. And the Germans will use one of their 2 blitz markers to increase the odds to 2-1. No combat event cards are played. We roll 1d6. The roll is a 4 and exchanged, followed by a required counterattack. We apply the exchange result first and each side loses one step. And now to the required counterattack result, the Americans have to either launch an immediate counterattack or apply a D result against the 9th U.S. Infantry. On a D result, the 9th U.S. can retreat 2 hexes or eliminate one step, which would eliminate the unit. And if it takes that last course of action, eliminating its last step, the Germans would not be able to advance into the vacated hex, different from a DR result, in which they could be able to advance into the vacated hex when the U.S. takes a step loss instead of retreating. And the Americans decide to counterattack, that is, 3 against 4, 1-2. And again, in a counterattack situation, the terrain of the defender is not considered. So there's no combat support markers nor any combat events, and we roll a die. The result is a 1, another counterattack. So the Germans will launch the counterattack. They don't want to stay in the position where they are. 4 against 3, that's 1-1, but we shift the odds one column to the right because of the armor bonus. So we're at 3-2. And the Germans will play their last blitz marker to increase the odds once again to 2-1. No support markers remain, and none of the sides will play any combat event cards. We roll the die. The result is a 6, a red DR defender retreats. So the 9th U.S. Infantry can either retreat 2 hexes or take a step loss, in which case the unit would be destroyed, to avoid the retreat. But in any event, the victorious German unit would be able to advance after combat. Remember, only in a D result, taking a step loss prevents the victorious units from advancing after combat, and this is a DR result. So the Americans will retreat 2 hexes into the town of Jella. And now the Germans have various choices. This was a red DR result, and the German unit is a mechanized unit, so it can advance 3 hexes, always advancing into the vacated hex first, and end its move here in this beachhead hex, destroying this beachhead marker, or it could advance 2 hexes, and then, during second combat, attack the 9th U.S., but if it does that, the defense strength of the 9th U.S. will be 3+2 for the beachhead marker. Now, these two options have the danger of leaving the German unit way behind its own lines, and the Allies could easily surround it in the next turn and eliminate it. So the Germans will stay close to their own lines and will not even advance into the vacated hex, and they will stay where they are. That's the end of the Allied combat phase for this second weekly turn. Now we proceed to the Allied reserve phase. As shown here, the Allies have 4 units that could be moved from the reserves box onto the map during this phase. However, the supply capacity of the Allies on the island of Sicily is at a maximum. For instance, take the landing zone of the Americans. They have 3 beachhead markers. Each provides 2 points of supply points for a total of 6. And the American units there consume all 6. We have, for example, the commando unit, 1. This one also 1 for 2. Another 1 for 3. This unit, another point for 4. And the second armor consumes 2 because of the oil drum symbol there, for a total of 6 supply points. A similar situation occurs around the British landing zone. We have a total of 6 supply points provided by the beachhead markers, and we have 1, 2, 3 units, 1 supply point each for 3. The 1st Canadian consumes 2, we're at 5, and the 5th Infantry consumes the 6th. The second SS parachute commando unit does not consume any of those supply points because it is a commando unit in a coastal hex. And the unit here, the 51st Highlander, is in a landing zone hex. It does not trace supply to beachhead markers. So as a result of the supply situation, none of the Allied units in the reserves box will be moved at this time to the map. Now we go to the German turn, and this second weekly turn, and we begin with the German supply phase. And in this supply phase, we check supply for all units from both sides. The 15th Panzer Grenadier Division is surrounded by enemy units and zones of control, so it cannot trace a supply line to the northern edge of the map. It is unsupplied, so we place a no supply marker on top of the unit. The American Ranger unit cannot trace a supply line of four hexes to the nearest beachhead marker because there's an enemy zone of control in between, so that unit is also out of supply, and we mark it accordingly. Now we move to the German movement phase of this second weekly turn, and the Germans have as a priority to extricate from being surrounded their two mobile units, the 15th Panzer Grenadiers and the Hermann Goering Panzer Division. The Panzer Grenadiers cannot move from an enemy zone of control to another hex that is in an enemy zone of control, so they have to stay there for now. The Hermann Goering Panzer Division, however, can move from this hex, which is in an enemy zone of control, to this adjacent hex, also in an enemy zone of control, because it is occupied by a friendly unit, and that's what it will do. And by entering the mountain hex in an enemy zone of control, it has to stop immediately. Now the Italian unit, which is in the same hex as the Hermann Goering Panzer Division, will move one hex across the Ditaino River and will stop there. The Italian unit, which is facing the Canadians and the British, will move to join the Italians who just crossed the Ditaino River. Next, the Italian unit currently occupying Messina will use the road movement bonus, and remember Italian units have a non-printed movement factor of 4, to move 1, 2, and 2.5 movement points to join the static division, which is defending Catania. And it will join that division in the ensuing counterblow battle. Next, Italian units in the western part of Sicily will try to help out the surrounded 15 Panzer Grenadiers. This two-strength Italian infantry division uses the road movement bonus, moving 1, 2, 2.5 plus the zone of control, 3.5 movement points, to move adjacent to the surrounded Rangers. And this unknown strength Italian unit also moves. And now both Italian units are adjacent to the unsupplied Ranger unit. And the unknown strength Italian division in this mountain hex moves one hex to the northeast to take a position surrounding the Ranger unit. Now we proceed to the German combat phase of this second weekly turn. And the Germans place any target markers on the hexes that they will attack. They will only place one on top of the Rangers that are surrounded and unsupplied. Now the Allies place any counterblow markers. The Allies wish to place two counterblow markers, one on top of the 3rd U.S. and the 2nd U.S. Armored Divisions. The Current Allied commander Alexander provides one free counterblow marker, shown in his card at the top left-hand corner, but that wouldn't be enough, so the Allies will play this card, Invasion Scare, for its discard value of 2. And that will add 2 counterblow markers in addition to the one that Alexander provides. So we place counterblow markers on the 3rd U.S. Infantry and the 2nd U.S. Armored Divisions. Now note that the Allies can place one more counterblow marker, and it could be placed on any of those units that are adjacent to Catania that don't have one, to force the 2 Italian units to make an even worse attack on the Allies. But the Allies decide not to place counterblow markers there in order to keep that hex in Catania fully stacked with Italian units and therefore prevent any reinforcing German units from occupying Catania. Now the Germans decide the order in which the battles will be resolved, and they will start with the battle between the Italians and the U.S. Ranger unit. The Italians total 4 combat factors, the Rangers 2, so we start at 2-1, but the Rangers occupy a hill hex. That shifts the odds 1 column to the left, so we're now at 3-2. However, the Rangers are unsupplied, and that provides a 2-column shift to the right when unsupplied units are defending, so now we're at 3-1. No combat support markers nor any combat event cards are played, so we roll 1d6. The roll is a 3, an exchange followed by required counterattack. In the exchange, each side loses 1 step, so the Italians reduce the 2-strength unit. And the Ranger unit, which is at its last step, is eliminated. And now we would implement the required counterattack result, but because a defender is eliminated, that part of the result is not implemented. So the net result is an exchange, and the Italians do not advance into the vacated hex. The eliminated Ranger unit is placed in the destroyed units box. It can return to the game by the Allies spending 1 replacement point for the reduced unit to be placed in the reserves box. Later during the game, it can be improved to its full strength side, but in the case of this particular unit, it cannot be improved to its full strength side before turn number 5. For now, it stays reduced in the destroyed units box, and to improve these units, you have to spend replacement points. Each card discarded represents 1 replacement point. The elimination of a square-shaped allied unit, in this case the Rangers, is one of those circumstances that causes movement to be made in the Italian war status track. So we move the marker there, 1 box to the right, and now the marker is in the Viva il Duce box, and if things stand as they are in the next turn, the Germans will receive 2 Italian units that will be drawn from the Italian draw cup. The next battle to be resolved is the counterblow battle between the 15th Panzer Grenadier Division and the 3rd U.S. Infantry and 2nd Armored Divisions. 4 attacking factors against 9 defending factors, and we start at 1-3. There are no terrain modifiers to be applied because this is a counterblow battle. There's no combat support markers, no combat event cards, so we roll 1d6. The result is a 2 counterattack. The defender may launch an immediate counterattack, and if that is done, we begin a new battle sequence. And the Americans will counterattack 9-4, 2-1, but there's a 2-column shift to the right because the defending units are unsupplied, so this is a 4-1 attack. The Germans have a tenacious defense attribute, but they will not use it because that will cause their elimination on a D or DR result, and actually they want to retreat, and they have a retreat path available. No combat event markers are played. We roll 1d6. The die roll is a 4. DR, defender, retreats. And the panzer grenadiers retreat 2 hexes. And live to fight another day. And the U.S. 3rd Infantry advances into the vacated hex, mountain hex, which stops any further advance. Now we go to the German reserve phase, and they have 2 units in their reserve box, the 29th Panzer Grenadiers and the 1st Parachute Division. German units moving from the reserve box onto the map may be placed in any hex within 4 hexes of a friendly controlled city or town, not adjacent to an enemy unit, or onto a fort marker. The 29th Panzer Grenadiers are placed in this hill hex that is within 4 hexes from Catania. And the 1st Parachute Division is placed in a hex adjacent to Catania. Now, in a regular game, the game would proceed to 2nd major offensive continuation. We move the major offensive track marker to the number 2 box to start the 3rd weekly turn. But that is where our example here ends. Here's the situation at the end of our example. We played 2 weekly turns out of 4 of the 1st game turn. So you can see that a lot happens in 1 game turn when we have a major offensive going on. A word here about reserve points. These are very important in the game. As you can see by this example, the Allies suffered some losses to their units that are now reduced. And with reserve points, you can purchase cards that can be used to rebuild units or bring previously destroyed units back onto the map. And that is important in order to keep a major offensive going. So this is the end of this example of play based on the Sicilia playbook example. And the next example will be assault on a fortified line. Example, the Germans have 4 fortification hexes placed in 4 hexes, these 2 mountain hexes, this hill hex here with the town of Casino, and also this mountain hex. And note that the fort markers, fortification markers, have variable strengths ranging from +1 to the +3, which is in Casino. Now let's place the German units. The Germans have 7 units. We start by placing the 94th Infantry with the 15th Panzer Grenadier, which starts reduced behind the 94th, the 71st Infantry Division, and in Casino, the Germans have the 44th HUD Infantry Division at reduced strength and the 1st Parachute Division full strength. And behind them is a Kampfgruppe unit. And finally, in the last fortification hex, the 5th Mountain Division. And now we place the 13 Allied units that appear in this example. We start with the 85th U.S. Infantry Division, with the 3rd Algerian Free French Mountain Division. And then there's another stack with the 88th U.S. Infantry Division, together with the 4th Free French Moroccan Mountain Division. Then we have the 2nd Free French Moroccan Mountain Division, together with the 1st Free French Motorized Infantry Division. And note that Free French units are green, and that means that they can stack with U.S. units with no penalty at all. Then we have 2 tan colored units behind the 1st Free French Infantry Division, the British 6th Armored and 4th Infantry Divisions. Next is the 8th Indian Division, together with the 2nd New Zealand Motorized Infantry Division. And next are two Polish units, the 3rd Infantry Division and the 5th Motorized Infantry Division. And finally, we add the 2nd SS/Parachute Commando Unit, a British unit, to the Polish stack, and that commando unit does not count for stacking purposes. This example of play consists of the Allied combat phase during January of 1944. So we place the turn marker here on the German side because the Germans have the strategic initiative until turn 12. Note that the color here of the turn is brown, meaning it is mud weather. And if this were a regular game, we would have this operation occurring, Anvil, Operation Avenger. In any event, the Allies receive one shock marker, and the Germans don't receive any blitz markers. The Allies have three cards in their hand. Let's take a look at them. Carpet Bombing. This card, as shown by the P-38 silhouette, cannot be used in mud or rainy weather. Therefore, this card is useless for its event. The next card, Volksgrenadiers, is a card that has a combat effect, but it cannot be used because it has a British roundel, meaning it can only be used when the Allies have the strategic initiative and the Germans have it in this turn. And finally, the last card, Artillery Time on Target. This card can be used during a battle sequence in the combat phase, and it's the only card that can be played by the Allies for its event. The commander of the Allied forces is General Alexander. The commander of the German forces is Kesselring. And in this example, the Germans have two cards, Assault Badge Wearers, which can be played during the combat phase, and the other one is 90 Day Wonders, which can also be played during the combat phase, and if we were playing the advanced game during attrition combat. So the Germans can play both of their cards. So now we begin the Allied combat phase. And the Allies will concentrate their attacks on the weakest parts of the defensive line. Here, attacking the 5th German Mountain Division, and here near Gaeta, attacking the 94th Infantry Division. So the Allies place their target markers, a regular target marker here, and the shock target marker that is given to the Allies as a result of Alexander's ability, the ST ability. He provides a shock target marker to the Allied side. So after the Allies place their target markers, now the Germans place any counterblow markers, and we have Kesselring's ability, the SC ability. He provides to his side a shock counterblow marker, which he will place on his strongest point on the line, which is the town of Cassino, where he has two units and a +3 fortification. And that will force the Allies to attack that very strong defensive position. The Allies choose to resolve first the attack on the 5th Mountain Division. So we start with the first attack, three tan-colored units attacking the 5th German Mountain Division, which is defending in a mountain hex and also with a fort marker that is a +2 marker. So we start with 10 combat factors. We add the 2 for the fort to the defenders, 10 to 5, that's 2-1. Now, normally the mountainous terrain gives the defenders two column shifts to the left, but because a commando unit is participating in the attack, that shift is reduced to only one shift to the left. So we're at 3-2. And in addition, the fort marker, in addition to adding strength to the occupants of the fortification, provides one column shift to the left. So we go from 3-2 to 1-1. And note also that between both hexes, there's an Apennine hexite. Normally that would cause another shift to the left, but because, again, a commando unit is participating in the attack, that column shift is negated, so we have a final 1-1 attack. None of the sides play any cards, so we roll 1d6. The result is a 6. A black D defender falls back. With the fallback results, the defending Germans have a choice. Because the unit has a black combat factor, it can stay and take a combat loss, in which case the Allies could not advance into the defending hex, or it can retreat two hexes. And by doing so, the Allies would occupy the fort hex. And the fort is a marker. It would be eliminated. Note also that the fort marker cannot absorb any losses because it is a brittle unit. It has a white combat factor. So the Germans have to choose between leaving or staying and taking a combat loss. And the Germans decide to absorb one step of combat loss, and they stay in the hex. And note now that the combat strength of the German unit, although it is reduced, now it has the tenacious defense capability. Now, because the Allies attacked a fort hex, they must take a step loss, and because the commando unit was used in the attack and its special ability to negate column shifts was used, it must take that step loss. So we eliminate the commando unit because it is a one-step unit. And the commando unit is placed in the destroyed units box. So that battle having been resolved, now the Allies choose the next battle to be resolved, and it will be the attack on the 94th Infantry Division. In this case, there will be four units attacking the German Infantry Division, two Free French units, and two American units. The four attacking units have a total strength of 16 combat factors. The Germans have three, but they're occupying a fortification with a +2 in mountainous terrain, so they have five. So we start 16-5, that is 3-1. Note that there's a river between two of the units and the defending Germans, but the river column shift to the left does not apply because there are no river hexes between all the attackers and the defenders. The defenders are in mountainous terrain, so normally that's a two column shift to the left. However, there are mountain units attacking, so only one column shift to the left is applied, so we go from 3-1 to 2-1. The Allies play no combat cards. The Germans play this one, 90 Day Wonders, which can be played when there's combat involving U.S. units. Now, before the die is rolled, the attack can be shifted two columns to the left or to the right. And in this case, the Germans will shift the combat two columns to the left. So now we go from 2-1 to 1-1. So a die is rolled on the 1-1 column. The result is a 4 counterblow. Now, we would roll on the blue CB column only if the final combat result table shift was to the right or if the attacker played a combat card. In this particular case, the final combat result table shift was to the left. If you remember, we started at 3-1 and ended at 1-1. And in this case, it was the defender that played a combat card. So we do not roll on the blue CB column. So the result calls for placing a counterblow marker on an attacking Allied unit. So when we flip this target marker, it does not have any counterblow symbol. So therefore, we remove the marker and no counterblow marker is placed. And now the Allies have to take a step loss because they attacked a fort. And it has to come from the mountain units, because the mountain units were used to negate one column shift for the defending mountainous terrain. So the Allies can elect to have the 4th Moroccan or 3rd Algerian absorb the combat loss, and it will be the 3rd Algerian Mountain Division that will take the loss. And now we proceed to resolve the Casino Counterblow battle. In this battle, we have 4 Allied units attacking 2 German units in a city hex in hill terrain with a fort plus 3 marker. Because this is a counterblow battle, the fort strength of 3 is not added to the defender's hex. So the defenders have 9 combat factors, while the attacking allies have 17. So this is 3-2. The allies use a shock marker, which happens to cancel the counterblow shock marker of the Germans. So we're still at 3-2. And note also that there are no terrain column shifts in this attack. So the hill terrain in the defender's hex does not have any effect, as well as the river hex side that divides all attackers from the defenders. So the final odds column is the 3-2 column. Because this is a counterblow battle, there are no shifts to the left because of the defender's terrain, which is hills, nor the river hex side that divides all attackers from all the defenders. Note, however, that here we have an attack between green units together with tan-colored units, and that produces a penalty of 1 column shift to the left. So we go from 3-2 now to 1-1. And now the Germans decide to use their tenacious defense ability, signified by the red combat factors, which in this case both defending units have. So that shifts the odds 1 column to the left, and the final column that we will use will be the 1-2 column. So no combat cards are applied. We roll 1d6. The result is a 3 counterattack. So now the Germans have the option of doing nothing or launching an immediate counterattack, and if they do so, there are no terrain modifiers that apply. So the Germans launch counterattack, and note that in a counterattack situation, the defender has to attack all the attacking Allied units. So it's 9 against 17 defending combat factors, that is 1-2, no terrain shifts apply. And now the Germans, to improve their chances, play this card, Assault Badge Wearers. And they can play it for 1 of 2 things: to shift the German attack 1 column to the right, or to roll 2 dice. And the Germans decide to use the card to roll 2 dice. So the Germans will roll 2 dice and select the most beneficial result. Note that the Allies have this card, Artillery Time on Target, but they cannot use this card because in the current combat, there are no U.S. units involved. If you take a look at the green-colored units, both are Free French units. So the Germans roll 2 dice and select the most beneficial die roll. The die rolls are a 1 and a 6. A 1 would be a counterattack result, which would cause the Allies to attack the Germans at 2-1 odds. The 6 result is a black D result. Defender falls back, and the Germans decide to apply that die roll. The defender falls back result makes the Allies have to take a decision. They either retreat their 4 units 2 hexes, in which case they will vacate 2 of their frontline hexes, or have 1 of their units absorb 1 step loss. And they will have the 8th Indian Infantry Division be flipped to its reduced side, absorbing the step loss and therefore not having to vacate their 2 hexes. And that's the end of the combat phase, and that's the end of this example of assault on a fortified line. This example gives you an idea of how tough it is to crack a fortified position in the mountains. And in this game, there's a lot of mountains in central Italy, and this will be a situation that players will encounter throughout the game. No Retreat, the Italian Front, is the latest installment in the No Retreat series. It depicts the Italian campaign in its entirety, from Sicily to the end of the war in northern Italy. There are not many games on the market that give you the full Italian campaign, and this one does. The game components are top-notch. The game brings new and fresh game mechanics to the No Retreat series, such as the commander cards, the optional but highly recommended attrition option, which we didn't have a chance to cover here, as well as various new combat results. For me, the event cards and the counterblow mechanic is what makes this game system so highly interactive and full of surprises. I hope this video gives you a good idea of the game's flow and what the game has to offer. This is Stuka Joe signing off for now. Thanks for watching.